Okay, so how is everyone today? Good? So last time we talked about reflections. So reflections are a special case of scaling. It is the case when you scale by a negative amount. So now, if we were to take you imagine yourself, and then looking at a planar plot of yourself, maybe looking at a mirror, and with the origin going right through your belly button. If you take all of your y coordinates and multiply them by 2, you'll be twice as big. If you take all of the coordinate system's y coordinates and multiply them by 2, you'll be half as big. Okay. Vertically. Okay, similar things for horizontal coordinates. Now, the thing that you need to understand is that now if you're looking at yourself with the origin right at your belly button and you multiply your y coordinates by -1, then what are you looking at? Looking at the vertical reflection of yourself. You'd be upside down. If you had a mirror like object and it took all of the x coordinates and multiplied them by -1, what would you be looking at? A horizontal reflection of yourself. Okay. Interesting. So that's what the reflections do. Now some functions have the interesting property that when you horizontally reflect them, there's no change. Can someone give us an example of a function that's the same even under a horizontal reflection?
Absolute value.
It's like a V, right? Like a V. And if you were to horizontally reflect it, that is to say, rotate it around the y-axis, it's still a V. Same. Another one would be the parabola. Okay. So such functions that have horizontal symmetry, they're important enough that they have that they're given their own name. What's their name? Starts with E. Even. So the functions with horizontal symmetry are said to be even. That's because the reason for that name is because if you restrict yourself entirely to the power functions, x to the n, then which functions have horizontal symmetry? Yeah, all those with even n. So x squared is an even function. x to 28 is an even function. They're all even. Okay. And then sort of by analogy, you could say, well, if functions can be even, maybe some functions can be odd. Okay, we do have a definition for that. What does it mean? So horizontal symmetry means even. What does odd mean? It's not vertically reflected. It's not vertical symmetry.
No.
There's only one function that can have vertical symmetry. The zero function, right? That'd be the only one. When you twist it over the x-axis, it's the same.
The horizontal reflection is the same as a vertical reflection.
Yeah. Horizontally reflecting it is the same as vertically reflecting it. Or equivalently, a horizontal reflection followed by a vertical reflection is the same as having done nothing. So, such functions are said to be odd. So, can you give me an example of an odd function? So just like Y is x squared is the prototype even function. What's the prototype odd function? Y is x cubed. Y is x cubed has that property. So, in fact, the power functions x to the n, which ones will be odd functions?
Odd exponents.
Yeah, those with odd exponents. And that's the reason for those names. So functions can have parity in an analogous way to integers having parity. Any questions about last time? Okay, so now we talk about
something interesting. So this is section 3.7. Inverse functions.
So in order to set the context right, we're going to take a trip down memory lane.
So first we're going to talk about addition. And in the first place, I want to know the identity of addition. That is to say, I want a number, the number,
that has the property that you can add it to x, and you'll always get x as a result.
Zero.
That's the number that does that. It is called the additive identity. So an example
of this, I could say please confirm that 3 and negative 3 are additive inverses.
Well, how do you do that? It's a question that's so easy, it's hard. Yeah, you add them.
Okay, what happens if I add them? 3 plus negative 3, well, what is that?
Zero.
That's 0. And why is that significant?
That's the identity.
Because that's the identity. That's why 3 and negative 3 are additive inverses. Because when you add them, you get the additive identity. Okay?
Two. What is the formula for the additive inverse of a given x?
So for example, what is the additive inverse of 8? Negative 8. What is the additive inverse of negative 9? 9. Or if you like, negative negative 9. So generally speaking, if I give you an x, what is the formula for the additive inverse of x?
Negate x.
Okay.
So I could say, you know, what is the additive inverse of negative 15? 15, right? And then as a follow-up question, I could say, well, why is it that 15 is the additive inverse of negative 15? Yeah, because when you add them, you get 0, which is the additive identity. That's the reason why. Okay. 3. The existence of the additive inverse of x. That is to say, I want to know for which x's do have an additive inverse? All of them do. Right. So let's confirm this. Can we agree that positive numbers have an additive inverse? So for example, like positive 77, its additive inverse is negative 77. And how about for negative numbers? Do they have additive inverses? Right, because the additive inverse of something like negative 93 would be positive 93. But what about 0? Does 0 have an additive inverse? Is there a number that you can add to 0 so that you'll get 0? 0. 0 is its own additive inverse. So all numbers have an additive inverse. Positive ones do, negative ones do, and 0 does. Okay. Now for product. What is the identity of product? One. It's one. Because now we're looking for a number such that x multiplied by that number is always x. That is to say, we want to know the number that multiplying by that number is the same as having done nothing. Well, that number is 1. And as an example, I could say, well, please confirm. So before I finish this, let me ask a couple out loud. What is the multiplicative inverse of 5? One fifth. What is the multiplicative inverse of 2/3?
Three halves.
Three halves. So now, to make it clear why those must be the answers, please confirm that negative 3/4 and negative 4/3 are multiplicative inverses. Okay. How do you do this? Multiply them. So let's multiply them. Negative 3/4 multiplied by negative 4/3. Okay. Do you observe the negatives will cancel? The 3s will cancel. The 4s will cancel. Supposing you carry out all of this cancellation, what is left? 1. And why is that significant? Because that's the multiplicative identity. So that's what confirms it. Okay. 2. What is the formula for the multiplicative inverse of x.
One over x.
Which is to say, reciprocal. So I could ask, what is the multiplicative inverse of negative 8? Not quite. So the first offer was 1 over 8. So why is that not the answer? So how would you confirm or deny that these are multiplicative inverses? You multiply them.
No, it's a negative.
Oh, you said negative? Yeah, I just didn't hear it.
I just didn't hear it. So then you were right in the first place.
Okay.
That's good.
Okay, good.
Then, finally, for multiplication,
now I want to know about the existence of multiplicative inverse of x.
Which x's have a multiplicative inverse? All but zero. Positive ones will. Negative ones will. But zero cannot. Zero cannot have one because, can you tell me a number that when multiplied by zero, you'll get a one? There isn't a number that'll do that.
So all x except x is 0. So it's important to know when something exists
before you go looking for it. All right, so one fun thing to do if you're a camping person. And if you're not, then this story is also important because you might know a camping person. One fun thing to do is to take a non-camping person camping and then say, okay, tonight we're going to try and catch a snipe. And you take them out in the woods with a bag and a bell and whatever other junk you have around your camp, and you say, okay, this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to go over about 100 feet over there and I'm going to try and scare a snipe over to you, and then you've got to throw the bag on it. I'm going to be ringing my bell and just do all kinds of crazy stuff. And the reason, why is that whole exercise funny? There is no such thing as a snipe, right? So it's like you've got your buddy out there with the bag, adrenaline going, and nothing's happening, right? So you have to be certain that something exists before you start trying to mess around finding it. Good. So, visually, the reason why there has to be an additive inverse for every conceivable x is because, remember when we were transforming functions? If we were playing with x's, then what kind of transformation is it? Horizontal or vertical? If we're playing with the x's. It's got to be horizontal. It'd be vertical if we were playing with the y's. Supposing that the operation that we're using is addition, is it going to be a shift or a scale? A shift. Because if it was a scale, it would be multiply or divide. So suppose we're shifting. Suppose I take this pencil. So let me do it. I guess I'll do it right here. Suppose I hold this pencil right here on that mark. And I shift it 3 units to the right. Is it possible to undo this? Yeah. How could I undo it? Correct, right? I could shift it -3 units to the right. Or if you like, three units to the left, right? Like so. So notice that no matter how I shift it, even if I shift it that way, is it possible to undo that? Sure. Any shift can be undone. That's why every number has to have an additive inverse. They all do. Now, multiplying, that is scaling something. That is to say, making something bigger. So now, if I take the pencil and I multiply the pencil by 2, not the coordinate system, but the pencil itself, that means the pencil would get bigger. So like this, right? Is it possible to undo this transformation? Could I get the pencil back to the normal size? Yeah, if it would just focus, right? Okay, now it's back to normal size. This is why I always lock the focus. Oh, come on. Okay, so now it's back to normal size. Now, if I multiply the pencil by 1/2, it'll shrink. Could I undo that? Yeah, by multiplying it by 2 and take it back. What if I multiply it by -1? Then, now it's like that, pointing the other way. Is it possible to undo it? Yeah, we'll do that. So, if I multiply it by 1/2, it's like this. If I multiply it by 1/10, like this. If I multiply it by 1/1000, little bitty baby pencil, right? But in principle, I could multiply it by 1,000 and get it back. What happens if I multiply the pencil by 0? No more pencil. It is gone. And there is nothing that you can multiply by nothing to get a pencil back, right? It's not going to happen. It's not the way it works. That's why you can't undo a multiplication by 0. It's gone. It's not there anymore. Okay. Now, the reason to go over this in such possibly overwrought detail is now, last week, we learned a new operation. What operation did we learn last week? It's the thing that functions can do that numbers can't. Starts with C. Compose, right? So we need to do all this. We need these three. For compose. That is to say, we need to know the identity of composition. We need to know when an inverse is going to exist. And then, supposing that it does exist, we need to know how to compute it. Okay? So that's the game plan for the next 2 lectures. We need to address these 3 concerns. So does everybody understand the game plan? Okay, so 0 is called the additive identity because when you add 0, that's the same as doing nothing. And 1 is called the multiplicative identity because when you multiply by 1, That's the same as doing nothing. So what we want is we want the compositional identity. We need a function such that when you compose with this function, that's the same as doing nothing. That's what we need.
Okay. Identity of compose. So please recall that the conceptual model that I requested of you to have for functions is as machines that accept inputs and outputs. So suppose that we have an F machine, like so. We've got an F machine. Suppose that I give it an X on the input side, what will come out on the output side? F of X. So now, imagining this as, you know, an enclosure with tools inside, I suppose, and this as a conveyor belt, do you agree that I would not end up changing the result if I just took this conveyor on the left and stretched it out and made it longer? Wouldn't change anything, right? So then what I'm saying is that what if I took this function and I set this machine and I did this, so far I'm just making a copy. So f of x comes over here. But suppose that I make the conveyor on the left much longer. And I put the x right there.
It's still the same, right? Alternatively,
what if I take the F machine as configured, and then I extend this side? Well, it's still F of X, right?
So what I'm saying is that if you're imagining this like a machine, the identity function is the function that, in a sense, just extends the assembly line a little further. Just makes it a little longer with a piece of conveyor belt.
So the identity function looks like this. It's a function that when you put in x,
what comes back out?
X.
A piece of conveyor. So the name of the additive identity is what? So its name is zero.
Oh.
Right? And the name of the multiplicative identity is
one.
This is the compositional identity, and it has a name.
And its name is ID.
The first two letters of the word identity. Which is to say,
it is the function ID of X is equal
to what?
X.
So this is the compositional identity.
Notably, observe what happens. If you do F composed with ID of X.
So how can we write this without the composition operator? That is to say, how do you write it with the parentheses stuff?
F parentheses ID of X.
Yes, F of ID of X.
Now, what is ID of X?
X.
So, composing F with ID was the same as not composing it with ID. So it didn't do anything. That's why it's called the identity. Now, because ID because x goes to id first, x goes to id first, which one of these two is that one? X goes to id first. So it's that one, right? That's making the path before you get to x, before you get to f, a little longer. So that's what this one is. How do you write the other one? ID composed with f. So now you're doing them in the other order. Now x goes to f first. So how do you write this without the composition operator?
ID.
Mm-hmm. ID of f of x. So now to understand what comes next, notice that in either way, so if you put, here's the ID function. If you put an apple in on the left side, What comes out on the right side? An apple, right? If you put in a giraffe, out comes a giraffe. If you put in a 4, out comes a 4. If you put in an f of x, out comes f of x. So, composing f with id like this is the same as not doing it at all. Because the x goes to f first, that's this one. Any question about it? So now we know the identity function. The identity of composition. It's like a little piece of conveyor belt. Right, if you had an assembly line, like if you've ever watched, say, cars being manufactured, the assembly lines are the stations are literally as close as they could possibly be, like side by side. But you know, you could take all those stations and actually put 100 feet in between all of them, and the end result would be exactly the same. Right? It's just it'd be longer. Okay. So now, for example, please confirm that f of x equal to 7x plus 3 and g of x is equal to x minus 3 divided by 7 are compositional inverses. Okay. So now, go back to this page. I asked you analogous questions before. I said, please confirm that 3 and negative 3 are additive inverses. How do you do that? You add them and confirm that you get the additive identity. Confirm these two, no, I didn't write it. So I could write another one. I could say confirm I did it right here. Confirm negative 3/4 and negative 4/3 are multiplicative inverses. Well, how do you do that? You multiply them and confirm that you get the multiplicative identity. Okay. So now I've given you two functions, and I'm saying, please confirm that these are compositional inverses. What must you do? You must compose them and show what? That you get the compositional identity. What we're saying
is two things. We've got two machines here, the F machine and the G machine. We need this to be true. So without regard to what's happening in the middle, if I put an X in, and they are in fact compositional inverses, then what has to come out? An X. And like this also. So if we wire them together like so, if I put an X in, what must come out? An X. Okay. We need both of these to be true. So, how about F circ G? Evaluate at X. So, by the way, I wrote this one down. Which one is this? So that is to say, here I've written two assemblies. Which one of the assemblies is this one? Yeah, that one. Why are these the same? Mm-hmm. Because G gets the X first.
Okay. So how do you write this without the circ operator?
Mm-hmm.
F of G of X. Okay. So then what F does, it does that. So it would be 7 G of X plus 3. And then G of X can be replaced with that.
Well, from here, can anything be simplified? So notice that the 7s can be canceled.
7s can be canceled. So you cancel the 7s.
Can any further simplification occur?
Yes.
The 3s go. So that's X.
Okay. Well, why is that significant?
Yeah, because that's ID of X.
So what we're saying, right? If you look at this expression, it looks kind of crazy. It's saying, okay, this is what I want you to do. I'm going to give you an X. First thing I want you to do is subtract 3, then take all that, divide by 7. And after you've done that, I want you to multiply by 7, and then add 3. And that altogether is a long-winded way to say, I want you to take that X and do nothing. Just take it right down the line. Just keep going. Which is kind of funny. Whenever I do exercises like this, you know, I imagine like a conveyor belt and a big old enclosure that I can't see inside. And you know, there's just anything ridiculous on the conveyor belt, like a cat. You know, just sitting there like a cat, and then going down the belt, and then it gets inside of the enclosure, and you hear all kinds of stuff, like saws, like and all kinds of screaming and yelling and everything, and then 5 seconds later, out the other side, it's the cat, completely untouched and unfazed, right? Just straight through. Okay. But this is not enough. This is not enough to confirm that they're inverses. What else? The other way too. So, how do you write this without circ? Yes.
Okay, so that'd be F of X minus 3 over 7. And that'd be 7x plus 3, and then minus 3 over 7. Now, do you observe that the 3's cancel in the numerator? And then the 7's cancel. And you get x, which is ID of x. So doing all that funny business to x is the same thing as doing nothing at all. That's why these functions are inverses. So now, you must check both orders because composition does not commute. And just to let you know, specifically, when I ask you, I will ask you questions about this, and it is very easy to generate two functions where in one order they are inverses, but in the other order they are not. And it'll be interesting to see why such a thing could be a case. Such could be the case. Okay, any question about this? Okay. So, now we know what the identity is. And if I gave you any two functions, I could ask you to confirm or deny that they are in fact inverses. You just check compositions in both orders. Okay. Now we need to know, well, just when do they exist? When does an inverse exist? So you don't get caught on a snipe hunt, right? So, existence of compositional inverse. So in the first place, when we first started talking about functions, we did the arrow diagram, and it is again useful for us. So suppose we call this the F rule, and the arrows are connected in this way. So this is a rule. My first question to you is this a function?
Yes.
Okay, what is the check to see it, to see if it is a function?
Right.
Yes. which is to say one arrow leaves all of these. Right? If there were two arrows leaving one of them, then it wouldn't be a function. Right, which is to say, we're talking about machines that when you put something in on the input side, just one thing comes out on the output side, not two things, just one thing. Okay, so is it a function? The answer is yes, because there's always one arrow leaving. The domain. So leaving the domain. So now I could ask, well, then you should be able to tell me, what is f of 1? B. What is f of 2? C. And what is f of 3? Okay, now imagine that this is a big machine, an enormous one, and you're standing over here. And you can't see the input side because the machine's too big, but you know exactly the way the machine works on the inside. Supposing you're here and your buddy is over here. And you're over here on the output side and you witness an A come out. Would you know unambiguously what was put in? Yeah, if you witness an A come out, for sure, what was put in? A 3.
because nothing else could possibly make an A. Notice that's true for all of these. It's true for all of the things in the range. So what I'm telling you is now we're going to imagine that this is a machine where you push inputs in on this side and outputs pop out. But notice for this machine it would work just as well. If you were over here and you saw a B come out, then you could push the B back in and one would come out on the other side. Okay? Now, getting away from calling this a machine and just back to functions, let's take this and let's keep the connectivity the same, but let's turn all the arrows around so that all the arrows are pointing the other way. If all the arrows were pointing the other way, is it still a function going that way? Yeah, because again, one arrow is leaving all of these. So it's a function going both ways. So this is a machine that can be run in reverse. It can make ones into Bs, and it can make Bs into As, going the other way. So going the other way,
that's called F inverse. So this is pronounced F inverse, and it's written F with a superscript -1. So I could say, for example, well, what is F inverse of C?
2.
And what's F inverse of A?
3.
Etc. So specifically, what I'm saying is that you could take this function 1, 2, 3 ABC 1, 2, 3, and you could do this to it. You could say, well, here's the F function.
So this one is the F function, and that's the F inverse function. What would happen if you put a 1 in on the left? What would come out on the right? A 1, right? What if you put in a 2? What would come out? A 2. What if you put in a 3? What would come out? A 3. So this is altogether a fancy conveyor belt. It just goes straight down the line.
What if we did F inverse 1? Would that be
defined? It's not defined.
Okay.
F inverse is only defined for A, B, and C. Yeah. Okay. So interesting. So this is an example of an invertible function.
And this is in contrast to this one.
So if we call this the G rule, then is G a function? Yes, because one arrow is leaving all of these. And again, if you're over here on the output side and you witness an A come out, do you know for sure what was put in if you witness an A come out?
Yes.
Yes. If you witness a B come out, do you know for sure what was put in? You do not. It could have been a 1, it could have been a 3. So what I'm saying is that if you were to be in this situation and you saw a B come out, if you tried to shove that B back in, the machine would break. It cannot be undone. Which is to say, take this machine and leave the connections the way they are, but turn the arrows around so that it's pointing that way. Is it a function pointing that way? It is not. because two things would be leaving B. As a result, this function is not invertible.
So, in the same way that 0 is not multiplicatively invertible,
0 doesn't have a multiplicative inverse, this is a function that is not compositionally invertible. Can't be inverted. This one can, this one cannot. So the property of having in the range just one arrow hitting everything, you already know the name of that property because we already talked about it. What is the name for the property where every arrow touches at most one thing over here? 1-to-1. Because one thing in the domain is going to exactly one thing in the range. But this is two things in the domain are going to one thing in the range.
So here's the upshot of this remark. One-to-one functions are invertible. And that's good because we already know
how to check. An easy check if a function is one-to-one. What is it? The horizontal line test.
So now, this is the last comment because we're out of time.
The horizontal line test, that is to say, every horizontal line crosses the plot at most once. Now in your mind's eye, imagine a parabola. Does a parabola pass the horizontal line test? No, right? Now, arithmetically, imagine that we have a machine, the squaring machine, the machine that you put an input in and it outputs the square of the input. And suppose that you're on the output side and you witness a 16 come out. Do you know for sure what was put in? You do not. What could have been put in? A 4 or a negative 4. Therefore, the squaring machine is not an invertible machine. You can't undo it. And we'll continue talking about this on Friday. So have a nice Wednesday.